special occasion. To start off the proceedings, I'll invite Professor Govind Swarup to come and first hand over a memento to our speaker, Professor Fanaroff, and then to introduce him to you.
Great pleasure in presenting to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I have a great pleasure in introducing Professor Parni Fanaroff. He's not only an outstanding radio astronomer, but a great human being. And if you come to know him, he's a very modest person. He did his BSc honors from the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa in 1970. Then got PhD from the University of Cambridge in 1974. I first read his paper, the famous paper 1974, during the UT radio telescope days when we were measuring double radio sources using the UT occultation survey, where Fanaroff and Riley published a paper, only 57 radio galaxies, classifying them into Fanaroff FR1 and FR2 based on luminosity of 2 into 10 power 25 at 178 megahertz, 2 into 25 watts per hertz per steradian. It's a remarkable paper which has stood the test of time, known as FR1, FR2 diatomy. It has been tested against thousands of radio galaxies and part of this conference which was also discussed. Then he returned from Cambridge, joined the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa for 3 years. Then he took a great challenge. He organized the Metal Workers Union in South Africa during the days of apartheid, as I know from India. And he remained his secretary for 17 years. In recognizing his great work, in 1993, he was appointed Deputy Director General in the office of President Mandela Nelson Mandela for Reconstruction Rehabilitation Program. By around 2000, the ISKA project was under international collaboration, making it was seemed a reality. And radio astronomers in South Africa recognize the importance of South Africa as a great site because low population density, very low radio frequency interference. So 2003, they requested Bernie took the responsibility of sponsoring SK project. In 2006 or 2007, I don't remember the exact year, I met him in Cambridge when I was part of the search committee. The four countries were Argentina, China, South Africa, Australia, where population densities are low. China is not low density, but they claimed in certain parts of China. And then we, that time, short-circuited, selected South Africa, Australia. It was not very clear where majority of antennas will be there. But 2012, with all the work that Bernie had managed to get strong support in South Africa from the government, from public scientists. So 2012, the International Committee decided to select South Africa, Australia for ISKA with majority of antennas in South Africa. During his leadership, Kare radio telescope was completed, and then Meerkat project was started, which consisting of, I remember, 64 antennas of 13.5 meter diameter, which is a pathfinder for SKA. That will be completed next year. Bernie is a fellow of the Royal Astronomical Society, visiting professor at Oxford University, and founder member of the South African Academy of Sciences. He got many honors. The greatest was 2013, the South Africa's greatest honor. Mapungubwe Silver. It's a great honor by the president of South Africa. So I invite Bernie to give his talk on astronomy, big data, and human capital development. Big challenge now is human capital development. Antennas will come, but it's not easy. Build manpower. Let's hear from him.
I would just request you to please turn off your cell phones or put them on silent. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the director very much for inviting me to give this lecture. I'm very honored to be giving one of the first lectures in this wonderful new campus that you built. And may I say that I wish you all the best for this to be a center of theoretical science throughout the world. I'm sure it will be that. Thank you very much to Professor Swarup for his very kind words. And thank you to all of you for attending. It's always easier when you have a captive audience because the bus only goes back later on. So you have the option of sitting outside or listening to me. So I'm glad you've chosen to listen to me. I'll try not to kill you with PowerPoint, but let's see. When I see people nodding off, I'll stop. Or perhaps a little bit before that. So I'm going to talk about the project that we've been able to build around the square kilometer array. As Professor Swarup said, the square kilometer array telescope will be built in South Africa and 8 other African countries and Australia. But we got into the project not only to advance science, but also to attract young people into science, to provide a career path for them in science and in engineering, and also to change the way in which South Africa and Africa were seen by the rest of the world. So I'll try and sketch that out for you in my talk. I'm afraid I won't say anything about jets. Listening to what everybody's been saying over the last few days, I can't add any value to that. At least I can try and add some value on this. So I want to say thank you especially to the organizers who brought me here for this invitation, and to say what an interesting conference it is. It's really been great. So I'm going to talk a bit about SK and SK science, but I won't dwell on that because you're all scientists and I'm sure most of you know those stories. I'll tell you a bit about what we've done in South Africa and the telescopes that we're building there. Some we're building ourselves, some in collaboration with others. The science program for our Meerkat telescope that the professor spoke about. And then another project that we're launching on top of SKA, and that is our Big Data Africa program. And then human capital development is a very, shall I say, business jargon way of putting it, but it really means bringing young people into science and keeping them there. So one of our reasons for getting into this as a country was that South Africa is a resource-based economy, and as we all know, resources are not worth much at the moment. And our future, as with most other countries that depend on resources, will have to include a significant component of the knowledge economy if we're going to be a successful and wealthy country, and if we're to reduce inequality, which is still very big in South Africa, even after 20 years of democracy. So, first of all, the Square Kilometre Array project is unique in that it's a mega project. It'll be the world's largest radio telescope, the world's largest science project. It's a global project involving countries on all the continents. It will do transformational science. It'll be built in two phases, so it'll start construction in 2018 and be completed somewhere around 2030. So it's a long project. And also because it's such a big project with such ambitious goals, it means that you require leaps in technology and in engineering. So just to say a little bit more about why South Africa would be spending money on a science project like this when we have problems of energy and housing and water and sewage and education and health and so on. Everybody recognizes that to develop, you need to have science and technology high up on the agenda. South Africa, as many other countries, doesn't have a good background in science. Most people in South Africa are very religious. They believe more in superstition than they know about science. So it's important for us to develop a consciousness and awareness of science in our people in South Africa, but also to give young people the understanding that there is a career in science and there's a career in engineering. In a lot of our schools, kids don't actually know what a career in science or in engineering means. They don't know what an engineer does or what a scientist does. We also wanted to change the perception. When we first entered the SKA site bid competition, some of our colleagues on other continents said, you can't be serious about building the world's biggest telescope with high technology and leading science in Africa, can you? And that's often how Africa is seen, as a basket case where, you know, you need aid, but you can't actually contribute anything much. So we wanted to show that you can actually do the world's best science and technology in Africa. And I think we've been fairly successful in doing that. We're getting a lot of young people now interested in science and technology. The SK is quite widely known. Those of you who've been to South Africa and have taken a taxi from Cape Town Airport to our office or the Johannesburg Airport to our office will know that most of the taxi drivers can tell you about the square kilometre array, which is good. We've also been able to get funding. The nice thing about mega projects is that they're very high profile, so you can get governments and other funders to unlock money which they wouldn't normally put into science. So if you tell them we've got 25 postdocs, but we like 30 postdocs, then they put that funding request into the pot and they measure it against all the other things that want money. But when you have a mega project and you can make them excited about it and they think, oh, this looks nice, then they find a separate pot of money to give you. And that's what we've been able to do. Also, because of the promise of things like big data, industry has been very interested. So we've been able to work with a lot of both international and local industry on this project. At the moment, we have 240 people who are directly employed by what we call Square Kilometre Array South Africa project. And then we have many others in the universities and in industry who are working with us. So just briefly, there are 10 countries in the SKA organization. India has recently signed its letter of intent to be part of the construction of Square Kilometre Array. Professor Yashwant Gupta is the member of the board of directors. The head office is at Jodrell Bank. And India is not only on the board, but is playing a significant role in particularly the software development to control the Square Kilometre Array. So together with South Africa, we have 8 other African countries. You can see them marked here. These countries which will be working with us, and Mauritius, which you can only just see there. So the Square Kilometre Array will be built in the first phase in South Africa, but then parts of it will be built in those countries after 2023, in the second phase. So because the SKA will be so big and so sensitive, it will give you a phenomenal view of the universe. You'll be able to see things you couldn't see before, but also the image resolution will be very good. And the survey speed will be much higher than anything that's gone before. So the sensitivity is intended to be about 50 times the sensitivity of the JVLA. We work with the 8 other African countries, and we've been able to get support from the heads of state of what's called the African Union, which is the union of all African nations. And we meet every 6 months with senior officials and ministers from those countries. So that's what the Square Kilometre Array will look like in South Africa. We're locating it in a place called the Northern Cape. It's a province of South Africa. It's 45% of our land area with only 2% of the population. So very low population density. And as you can see, the countryside will be covered in these dishes. And also, if the technology works out, what are called mid-frequency aperture arrays. So at the moment, as Professor Swarup said, we're building the Meerkat telescope. We started building the CAT telescope, which is Karoo Array Telescope. The Karoo is this area of the country. It's a semi-desert area. And then we managed to persuade the National Treasury to give us more money. So in Afrikaans, which is one of the South African languages, more is meer. So we said, this is Meerkat. It's more of the original CAT telescope. So we're going to complete that early in 2017. The maximum baseline will be 8 kilometers. And then what's called SK1-MID, the mid-frequency dish array, will be built going out about 150 kilometers. There'll be a total of 197 dishes, which should be completed by 2022. And then from 2023, another 2,000 or so dishes, which will be spread throughout Africa, as you saw. Then in Western Australia, in the first phase, there'll be 125,000 of these low-frequency antennas, and then there'll probably be up to 1 million in the second phase. So, of course, the SK will be one of the great new observatories of the future, and I really envy the young people among us because you're coming into a golden age of astronomy. I just hope there are postdocs and positions for you to be in because the amount of data coming out of this is going to be phenomenal. And I hope you'll be around to be able to analyze it and write groundbreaking papers from it. So the science case for the SKA covers a number of things which most of you will be familiar with. Tests of relativity, the formation, the epoch of reionization, the formation of first stars and galaxies, looking at the development of the large-scale structure, how magnetic fields originate, and then the formation of protoplanetary disks, and of course SETI as one of the examples. But it's not only science that will be transformational, the technology is transformational. The amount of data coming out of the telescope is huge, and so it's been necessary to look at the development of new technologies, and that's why companies like IBM and Cisco and others have been very active in working with us. Because the challenges of the SKA in this area of big data are the challenges that they'll be facing with their clients in 5 or 10 years' time. So you can see that the rates at which data will be transported and the speed at which you'll have to process the data and store the data are very large. And of course, this means that you've got to develop new hardware, but you've also got to develop new algorithms. And that's one of the reasons why it's very interesting to the ICT industry. So this is just some numbers for the Meerkat. So going into the correlator, which combines, as you know, the signals from the different dishes, you'll have 2 terabits per second. For the first phase, the SKA dish array, you'll have 20. And then for the second phase, you'll have 5 petabits per second. The compute load there is 500 teraflops going up to 3 exaflops. So these are very challenging, and in particular, they're very challenging in terms of the power requirements, because to deliver 50 megawatts in the middle of nowhere is not cheap. You want to keep the cost down as well as the effect on climate. So just an example of the sensitivity of the SKA. With current techniques, you can detect if someone is beaming a message to you. With phase one, you'll be able to detect an airport radar on nearby planets around nearby stars. And then with phase two, you'll be able to detect television broadcasts, or so they tell us. I think most of you know all that stuff. So what we'll be doing in the science case is a large H1 intensity mapping survey, large continuum surveys, and combining the low frequency surveys with the intensity mapping surveys to give us these distributions of hydrogen on cosmological scales to look at the large scale structure of the universe and how that develops. So you're all aware also that one of the key science cases in pulsars. The idea is to detect every pulsar on the Milky Way and time them to better than a few tens of nanoseconds so that you can use them as a detector for gravitational waves by looking at nanosecond changes in arrival times. And then, of course, another example is a transient radio sky. It'll be a very sensitive detector of these transients. And you can see that the estimate is that there should be 10,000 per sky per day. So we should be able to see quite a lot of them and hopefully get a position for them and identify the sources. So what we're doing in SK South Africa, we had to do the site bid. We're preparing a greenfield site, which I'll show you, building this meerkat array. We have to protect the radio quietness of the site. That's one of the most important things for the telescope. We're part of the design and the governance of the square kilometer array. We're building up young people. We do community development and outreach. And in order to develop capacity in our African partner countries, we've started this African Very Long Baseline Interferometry Network project, which I'll talk about. And then we host and collaborate on a number of other telescopes. So we do quite a lot of different things. So that's a map of South Africa. This is where the population is, and that's where the population isn't. So this is the Northern Cape province, and you can see it's empty. Not quite empty, some sheep and a few people, but that's where the telescope will go. And that area there is controlled by law. So Parliament passed a law called the Astronomy Geographic Advantage Act, which is aimed specifically to support the SKA. And it gives the Minister of Science and Technology to prohibit any activities in that area which could interfere with it, with astronomy. So at the moment, we're negotiating with the oil companies because they want to do fracking in the area, but they can't do fracking without our permission. So there's the regulated area. This is a little town, Carnarvon, which has about 3,000 people in it, and that's 80 kilometers to our site. There are other tiny little towns in that area. That's what the area looks like, and it was chosen because it's so empty. So where you've got people, you've got radio interference, as you know. Where you haven't got people, you've got less radio interference. So you can see it's very open, empty countryside. That's what it looked like in 2003. Some of you will know Justin Jonas. We were looking at this with a view to deciding whether this was the appropriate place to build. Now, because we want to maintain radio quietness, we've prevented the development of mobile phones in the area. So because in South Africa's constitution, everyone has a right to telecommunications, we've put in a system, satellite-based system, which won't interfere with the SKA, and all the farms and workers on the farms can get satellite voice and data connection. And later this year, we'll be putting in a mobile system as well. So because the project has such a high profile, it's been listed as one of South Africa's keynote infrastructure programs. There are 18 of them, and they report to this Presidential Infrastructure Coordinating Commission, which is good for us because if there are any bottlenecks between us and any government departments, we can go through that level. We don't have to start at the bottom, and that helps a lot. So this is when our president came to inaugurate the Cat7 dishes out there on our site with some of our staff. And this is more recent, earlier this year, when the deputy president came along to inaugurate one of our new meerkat dishes. And these are some of our young operators doing a demonstration for him. So we've had very good support from government, but the way we've ensured we keep that is that we make sure we under-promise and over-deliver. So we always make sure that we deliver on what we've told people, because if you don't, then you quickly lose support. We've also taken a lot of ministers from other countries out, and it's been very important. The Portuguese Minister of Science was there recently, and Portugal has now announced that they're going to join the Square Kilometre Array fairly soon. So this was in 2014. There's the Indian High Commissioner, the Chinese Science Minister, the Russian Science Minister, the Brazilian Science Minister, and this guy was the South African Science Minister at the time. So there will be an astronomy meeting under this BRICS. I don't know if you're all aware of BRICS. It's the organization of Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. And they have now organized an astronomy committee, which is chaired by the South African Minister of Science, and there'll be a meeting in December to discuss astronomy. So I would suggest that you make contact with your minister and make sure you have a voice in it. So we had to put a lot of infrastructure in. This is a specially designed power line going 80 kilometers from Carnarvon to the site. It was designed so it doesn't spark, because the sparks, of course, would interfere with the telescope. We had to upgrade the road, and we're now in the process of tarring that road. We put in a big optical fiber, and of course, we had to put in reticulation on the site. So we've got a 10 gigabit per second line going down to Cape Town, where our head office is, and we're upgrading that to 20 gigabits. And then Carnarvon, this little town, has the fastest broadband in South Africa, because we've plumbed it into the schools and into what we call our community knowledge center as well. That's what the site looks like from the air. That's the CAT-7. We built this as an engineering prototype because we never built an interferometer. So we didn't want to build 64 dishes and then find we'd done it wrong. So we built 7, and it worked so well that it's been used as a science instrument as soon as we finished the engineering. Now it's falling to pieces, but people who are using it don't want to let it go. So we're wondering how we're going to pay to upgrade it. And those are the foundations for the meerkat dishes. You can see it's a close-packed array, and the idea is to have a good layout for pulsar science and for H1 neutral hydrogen surveys. I think we should have put in a few longer baselines, but I was persuaded otherwise. Our control room's in Cape Town, so it's all controlled remotely, and the idea is to have very few, if any, people on site, just a few technicians. So on the site, we have a buried bunker, and the idea is to keep anything which would generate radio interference, like computers and the correlator racks and so on, underground in a Faraday cage. So in that, we also have our rotary UPS. That's 2.5 megawatts of uninterruptible power supply. It's a rotary, so it smooths out the power to the telescope, because otherwise we find if there's spikes, it kicks out our helium coolers. This is where we assemble the dishes. And this is the Faraday cage room. So those are the racks for the meerkat, and the rest of it will be the racks for the SKA. But we test everything that goes on site. So we have our own reverberation chamber in our Cape Town office, and every single bit of equipment that goes on site is tested there to very stringent standards to make sure that when we get it on site, it won't interfere, because there's no point in controlling mobile phones and TV and all the rest of it, and then you bring your laptop on site and you saturate all the receivers. So everything is tested and everything has to be approved. So the meerkat, as Professor Swarup said, is a precursor to SKA. It was designed and developed by us in South Africa. It will be integrated into the first phase of SKA in 2022. And what we've learned in constructing the meerkat, I think, is providing very useful lessons for the design of the SKA itself. So we decided to maximize sensitivity, and dynamic range. It's 64 antennas. 48 of them are in a very small core area of a kilometer, as I showed you. And we're having three sets of receivers, UHF, L-band, and S-band. We originally hoped to have X-band as well, but I don't think we're going to have the funds for that. Those are our first two dishes. You may remember that the Cat7 dishes were prime-focused dishes with the feeds in the center. These are offset because they give us a much cleaner beam. So we'll have a very nice beam from this. And you can see the beam there. So this is the beam with the offset Gregorian optics, and that's the beam with the prime focus. And one of the conditions of our contracts is that 75% by value has to be sourced in South Africa. So some new factories have had to be opened to comply with that. We've been very lucky in that the team that we have in our offices are really good people, very good young South Africans who've worked with local industry, and they've done such a good job designing the optics and the receivers that we get four times the advertised survey speed at no additional cost. So we've made those receivers available to Canadians. They've said it's superb engineering, so we're very proud of that. And the telescope is looking so good that the Max Planck Institute is investing 11 million euros in a set of S-band receivers, mainly for pulsar work. So we do our first array release in the middle of next year. That'll be 16 antennas. Then we'll start with early science, and then we'll do 32, and then 64, and so on. But by the end of this year, we hope to form our first image. So this is just to give you an idea of what we'll have. This is the sensitivity. That's a JVLA for comparison. This is what we originally advertised when we asked people to apply for time on the telescope, and this is what we have now. So you can see the sensitivity is quite a lot better than the JVLA, and the survey speed is a lot better. So this is the science capability. You can see it covers... You can't see, unfortunately, you can't see the frequency very well there. But it'll go from about 400 megahertz up to 5 gigahertz there. So these are the S-band receivers from Max Planck. These are the ones that we're providing. We designed this to be industrial because if you're building 64 dishes, you can't do it in the old way of building the dishes in the backyard of a university. And when you're building 2,000 of them for the SKA, you need to do it on an industrial scale. So we designed these dishes so that they can be built in Johannesburg. Whoops. How did that happen? So the engineering can be done in Johannesburg, and then they're assembled in our dish shed on the site. Then we put them on a trailer, and we take them out to the site, and then we just assemble them with a crane. So they're very easy to assemble. And we've done a lot of work on logistics, which also is not usually done for telescopes. So we've made sure that we understand very well how we balance capital cost against the cost of operations and maintenance, and how we get maximum availability. Another area that we've done some innovative work is in the correlator, where we're using we use Ethernet to communicate instead of having hardwired communications. So that means we can upgrade our boards as often as we want to and still use the same communication method. And we designed these boards in a project with Berkeley and the National Radio Astronomy Observatory, NRAO, for Generation 1, but Generation 2 and 3 we've designed in Cape Town. And I'm glad to be able to say that we now sell technology to NASA. I like that concept that South Africa is selling technology to America, especially to NASA. That's Joe Lazio, some of you know him. In order to make the best possible use of all the sensitivity, we've got a very good team working on calibration and imaging. led by Oleg Smirnov. Many of you know him from Astron. So Oleg's got a big team now, and he's been working with Rick Perley to get into the Guinness Book of Records for the maximum dynamic range. So this is their latest Cygnus A map. They haven't published it yet, but Oleg gave me permission to show you. And they're doing a lot of work with some of our Indian postdocs and staff members on a whole range of very new algorithms and methods, and also accelerating the requirements for computing. Then they also work on Bayesian methods. And please don't ask me questions about how they do it, because I definitely can't answer, and I'll refer you to Oleg. This is just an idea of how many different scientists have applied for time on the Meerkat telescope. And we're going to review that again in May, because now we've got more sensitivity, so we'll have more capacity for science. And of course, this was 5 years ago, so science has changed a bit. The two key projects are pulsar timing and H1 surveys, but we have a whole lot of other projects as well. And if you want details, I'm going to put this talk on the website, but you can find it on our SKA South Africa website as well. And there are a number of Indian astronomers involved with these projects, I'm glad to say. Perhaps not as many. One of the side effects of this is that we've developed really good cosmology capacity in South Africa. And we've been able to use that as part of our outreach. So we make sure that the public knows how good the teams are. Then because we've got a very good site, we've got other telescopes on the site. So one of them is the Paper Telescope, looking for the epoch of reionization, when the first stars and quasars turn on in the universe and reionize the cold hydrogen. And Paper's been running for some time. And you can see all the different groups that are working on that, some South African, some American. We're now moving on to the HERA telescope. And again, you can see there's a large number of different collaborators. So at the moment, we're building 17 dishes as a prototype. And then Cambridge University is funding another set of dishes. So we'll have 37, which will run as a prototype. And if any of you want to collaborate, Kavalan Woodley at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in Durban speaks on behalf of the South African part of this collaboration. And then, of course, we've been working with Tony Reedhead and others on CBAS to survey the foregrounds so that they can do the best possible work on microwave background fluctuations. So that will be doing groundbreaking work too, I'm glad to say. And then there's a project now to build what's called HIRAX, the hydrogen intensity in real-time analysis, so measuring dark energy through 21 centimeter intensity mapping. It's based on the Canadian CHIME experiment. The university in KwaZulu-Natal is supporting this, and we even managed to persuade the municipality of Durban that it was in their interest to support this. So they're also putting money into it, which I think is the first time a municipality has contributed to building a telescope. So data processing and big data is a big thing for us. We don't want to be in a position where data are collected in South Africa and then sent overseas, and the papers are written overseas and Nobel Prizes are won. And I've got nothing against the Netherlands or anywhere else, but I'd like us to win the Nobel Prize in South Africa. So if you don't mind sharing them. So in order to do that, we've got to have the capacity to do the data analysis. And so we've launched this program, Big Data Africa, which we have support from the Department of Science and Technology. So we're focusing it around the SKA because the SKA's data demands are very challenging. So it's a good opportunity to get into these areas. And we want to use the SKA in Africa to develop a critical mass of big data skills and activities, not only in astronomy, but going beyond that And we've said that we want South Africa to be a world leader in big data by 2020. Cisco, for instance, says that the big data economy will be worth $1 trillion by 2020. So we said, well, that's fine. We'd like a percentage of that. So in order to do that, we've got to develop the skills and the ability to produce there. So Russ Taylor has come to South Africa, and he's now started the Inter-University Center for Data Intensive Astronomy, which was launched last month. We've got 8 South African universities, and we're going to launch, bring more of them in, and then we'll use it to link up with universities in the other 8 African countries that we're working with. And IBM has now established a research center in Johannesburg, and SK is one of their 3 focus areas. Now we're starting to work on a project to build what we call the African Research Cloud, and that will link universities in South Africa and in Africa with universities in Europe and the rest of the world. And running with that, we've got a training program for African astronomers and data scientists supported by what's called the Newton Fund, which is jointly funded by South Africa and the UK. So the challenges for SKA are particularly power-efficient supercomputing, stream processing, high-quality pipelines, wide-field calibration, real-time processing, and the serendipitous discovery. And then, of course, SKA2 takes it even further because you're dealing with huge scales there. So machine learning becomes essential. So we're doing a lot of work ourselves on innovation in this area. We've developed some power-efficient micro servers. We just take the boards and we dip them in a fish tank of oil, so you don't need to cool them. And that saves us a lot of power. And we're working on a lot of other computing methods. But in particular, we're working on machine learning. And we're applying that to maintenance and various other things. So those are the big data areas we're working on. You can see various things here, which I think are generally of interest. And these are the areas of machine learning. One of the jobs I've given to our team is to develop what we call a serendipity machine. You'll have huge volumes of data coming out of the SKA, and the PIs will develop data processing plans which will get out of the data what they wanted. So if you're doing an H1 survey, you'll get an H1 survey out of the data. Then you throw away this room full of data and you go on to the next survey. So I said to the guys, that sounds like a hell of a waste of money to me. Why can't we make a machine learning program that'll go into all this room full of data and find the things that you didn't know were there? Because all these telescopes become famous for discovering things that they weren't expected to discover. But the problem with these huge mounds of data is there's so much data processing that you process for what you were looking for, but you don't necessarily see anything else. You know, Tony and Jocelyn Bell were lucky. They had a pen recorder, and when the pulsar blipped on that, they could say, oh, look, that doesn't look right. But when you've got a room full of numbers, it's a bit more difficult to do that. So I've asked them to do the impossible, to find the unknown unknowns through the serendipity machine. I hope they seem to be making good progress. Then we also are training people. So what we've tried to do is to make a pipeline from school to tenured position to train astronomers, engineers, technicians, and artisans, so that we know that we can build and operate the Meerkat and the SKA and win the Nobel Prizes. And as I say, not being greedy, we're happy to share them with you, but some of them must be in South Africa. We're also training scientists and engineers from the other African partner countries, and we've been able to reverse the brain drain. So we've got some very good young and more senior researchers who've come to work in South Africa, quite a lot from India, I must say, doing very good work. We've been able to create research chairs in the South African universities, and we give them a package of postdocs, PhDs, and MSCs, and travel and equipment grants and so on. And those are for 10 years, and then the university is expected to take them over. We create postdoctoral positions and bursaries as well, and we run this very hands-on because we found that just offering bursaries and then leaving people on their own didn't actually succeed. So we work with the universities to find the students, and then we make the students feel part of a team. The undergraduate students have to come to a winter school and a summer school. They've got to feel part of the team. They've got to give us a report every 6 months. We follow them up. We know who they are. When they graduate, we follow their careers as well. So because we're very hands-on, we've been quite successful. So at the end of every year, we run a conference for all of our graduate student bursary holders and postdocs and their supervisors. And it's very successful because we want people to feel like they're part of a team. We don't want them to be isolated, spread out in the universities, never hear from anybody else, all on your own. So they all come together in Cape Town or near Cape Town at the end of the year. It started off being 2 days. It's now a week and a half because there's so many people and so many papers. And we force people to present. So from your first year, you have to do a poster. And then when you're doing a PhD, you have to do a talk. Because my theory is if you don't talk about what you're doing and you can't present what you're doing, then you don't understand it anyway. So you can see this has grown quite a lot from our first conference in 2006. And we've now got a lot of people in the program. We also have what we call a young professionals program. We've been struggling to get enough women and enough black students into our graduate program. And also into our senior levels of engineers and scientists. So what we do is that we take the best students from our bursary program, and we also advertise widely, and we bring young people to our office in Cape Town for 3 days. We had 450 applicants this year. We selected 40 of them. They came for 3 days, and they do projects with our staff, and then we select this year we appointed five. Next year, we're going to appoint 10 young people, and then they form part of our staff, but they can also continue with a PhD if they want to. And then, as I say, we're doing training in the other African countries. This was the launch of the program in Zambia recently. We've run workshops in Kenya and Madagascar and Mauritius and Namibia and Botswana and so on. So those are the bursaries. We've given out 717 so far. We give them right across the spectrum, from research chairs, six research chairs, all the way through PhD and MSc. We support some staff as well, honours students, master's students, Bachelor of Technology. This is artisan training, and this is further education and training colleges. We're introducing a new program now, which will be senior postdocs, because people have pointed out to us that everybody around the world is struggling to get tenured positions. So we want to be able to get the best young people from around the world. So we're going to go to the universities and say, we'll give you a 5-year senior postdoc, provided you guarantee to us that if the person performs well, you will convert that into a tenured position before the end of the 5 years. So in that way, we'll snap up from all of you the best young people, because they can't get tenured positions in your universities, they can come to ours. I'm sure you don't mind. So that's how our bursaries are distributed between astrophysics and astronomy and engineering. We give a lot for engineering because it's a key part of the program. We don't have enough women in the program, as you can see. They're mainly in the astronomy, not in the engineering. But we do, as I say, have a special focus on getting more women into the program. And we also give a lot of bursaries to people from our other African partner countries, but we're now going to create a separate program for them and give more bursaries for South Africans. So we've graduated a lot of people over the period, as you can see. And this is how our pipeline is working. So from undergraduate to honours degree, from honours to MSc, MSc to PhD, PhD to postdoc. So we're getting people who are coming right through the pipeline now. Especially for women and for black students, it's been quite difficult to retain people in this. So people come under pressure after they've done a first degree. Their families want them to go out and work. So we've had to be able to keep people in the system and take them right through. And that's been quite challenging. We also do on-the-job training for people from that Carnarvon area, because Unemployment there is about 85%. And we've been working with the schools. We've been training artisans, and we employ them then. So we train them job skills, and then we employ them. We have what we call a community knowledge center, which some of our industrial partners have equipped for us, and we train people from the towns in various skills. And then we force all our big contractors to hire local labor and local subcontractors, but we've had to train the local subcontractors because they don't know how to quote and they don't have a lot of the skills for contracting. So we run quite a big program to train them and to finance them. And for the first time now, we're likely to have students from the area who can actually go to university. They've had no maths and science teachers in that area for a very long time. So we've had to bring in maths and science teachers and work with the schools to develop maths and science teaching. Then we're almost finished, so I hope you're all still awake. The bus isn't here yet. This is our African VLBI network. So these are second-hand, slightly used satellite communication dishes. That's one in Ghana. That's one in Kenya. And these dishes are no longer needed because they have terrestrial optical fiber networks. So Vodafone has donated this one to the Ghanaian government. And we've been working with the Ghanaians to convert it for astronomy. And then we train their people either in Cape Town or in Ghana. And we're doing the same in Kenya and in Zambia. So as you can see from a before and after, we've had to virtually rebuild this dish and develop a team in Ghana. So our people go up there regularly. You can see the dish is not in very good condition. So we've had to replace virtually everything. You can see the tripod legs there, very worn. But we'll get first light from there early next year, and we hope to get fringes by later next year between Ghana and South Africa. And that's our website. Thank you.
So I'm sure Bernie will be happy to take a few questions. Yes, Ruby?
So this is quite personal question, but I want your view. As an astrophysics student, when I try to see connection between me and society, and I feel that I don't feel any connection because my friends, my neighbor, and society doesn't know what I am doing. Though sometimes I try to make them understand that, okay, I'm searching for, though I'm sitting in office and searching for binary agents, government is paying money, but still, when I try to make them understand that, okay, this is the thing, they ask me that, what is the need for this? What is the benefit for this? And I feel a little bit low for that. So I want your view on.
That's a very common problem, which I think all of us face. We found quite early on that young people in the schools don't actually know what a career in science means. What do you do when you're a scientist? They don't know what an engineer does. They know what a lawyer does, and they know what a doctor does.
Okay, so if I tell them that engineer, and if I say that antenna, for technology there is some chance that they can understand, they can sense something, but for science, for astrophysics, I feel the lack of that connection.
So we do outreach. There are a number of science fairs around the country, and schools come to those science fairs. And we have people who go to all the science fairs. We do exhibitions. We've done some comics for kids. We call this Mission Meerkat. So it's a comic that explains what the SKA is and what astronomy is. We try and get onto TV and in the newspapers as often as we can. And we also work with the schools. And we've got some very good young people in our project who have come up themselves from rural areas or from very poor schools in what used to be the black townships in South Africa. And they are very keen to get other kids involved. And I've been working with some of these kids. And the problem is that they want to solve all of South Africa's problems at the same time. So I've had to say to them, let's choose a few schools and work with those schools and get kids to understand and let's bring them in. But you've also got to be able to say there is a career path. And that's why we've had to develop the opportunities. So you don't want to go to kids and get them all excited about astronomy and there's a future in astronomy. And then they say, okay, I want to do astronomy. And you say, sorry, there's nothing I can give you. So that's one of the issues, and that's one of the reasons why we're doing the big data program, because we know there's going to be a lot of work in big data as well.
Okay, so like people are the awareness, the outreach is for to give them the flavor of astrophysics, and people are coming, joining astrophysics. But another issue is that who all are not doing astrophysics, and they want to know that what is the benefit of it. So that time what we should say.
Well, I'm not sure how you can explain the benefits because there are different benefits for different people. We've tried to get young people excited about two things. One is to understand astronomy just by looking up in the sky and being excited by finding out what's going on. And the other one is to persuade them and their families that doing training in astrophysics is going to actually benefit you in the long term, because if you're trained as an astrophysicist, you can not only work as an astrophysicist, but you can work almost anywhere with those skills. So those are the messages we're trying to get across to people, but it's not easy. A lot of young people say, well, I want to get a BMW. How long will it take me to get a BMW if I become an astronomer? And we have to say it can take a long time. Yeah. So at the moment, the most popular, if you ask young people in South Africa what their ambition is, most of them want to work for government because it's seen as being a secure job, pays well, and you don't have to work too hard. None of that's true in astronomy.
Rajesh?
A couple of questions. The first one, I got the impression from a couple of your slides that the dishes are arranged in spiral arms. Is that correct?
Yes, for the SKA. Yeah.
Is there a simple reason for that?
It's a configuration that was worked out to optimize the imaging, but also to minimize the cost. So if you can reticulate power, for instance, along a spiral arm or optical fiber along a spiral arm, if you've got a completely random distribution, you can get good imaging, but then you've got to have lots and lots of reticulation and it becomes extremely expensive. But it does give you good imaging also.
Okay, and the second question is the social general question about you said 75% of the value, is supposed to be generated from South Africa built instrumentation and so on. So how do you work with the industries that are supposed to make these and ensure their quality is to the level you would like it to be? Was that a big challenge?
So it depends what kind of contract. The people who are working on the receivers, a company called EMSS, we brought them in right at the beginning of the project and we said, we'll pay you on the basis that we pay a cost plus a little bit, but under your normal rates. And then you work with us. So they've been working with us for 10 years developing receivers and designs and so on. Most of our contracts go out on tender, and then we write into the contract for the company that wins the tender. We write, you've got to employ subcontractors and you've got to source your materials in South Africa, and it's your job to make sure you get those things. And if you don't get them, then you'll pay a penalty. So building the dishes at the moment is GD Satcom. They are in partnership with a South African company called Stratosat. So GD Satcom had to get local partners, and they've got to look after the quality. And we are very strict with the quality. And since we're all friends here, you won't mind me telling you this in confidence, but we fought with GD Satcom for about 2.5 years because they said, we built the ALMA dishes. We know how to do this. Don't tell us what to do. And we said, nope, we don't care what you built before. You build it our way. And it took them 2.5 years to accept that and to get their South African contractors to produce to quality. So we fell back a few months, but we hope they'll be able to catch it up. But you just got to put pressure. So we don't do it with all the subcontractors ourselves. We do it through the main contractors. And the same with building the roads or anything else.
Rosa?
This is a social question. South Africa has obviously invested a lot into SKA, and likewise SKA hopes to invest a lot into South African society. Internationally, South Africa is perceived as having a fairly high crime rate, a violent crime rate. I was wondering whether you had to resort to special measures to protect your instrumentation, to protect the teams, whether you are hoping that somehow SKA will somewhat provide some sort of a minor resolution to the problem.
The answer is no, we don't have to. Protecting the instrumentation. If you want to steal something from the SKA, you've got to be really serious because you've got to drive for 9 hours from Cape Town to get there.
And that's practical.
The farmers are amazing, you know. If you drive up there, it's just empty. There's nothing. And you climb over somebody's fence and you put your feet on the land. And within 5 minutes, a car will arrive and the car will say, can I help you? Out of nowhere, you know. So people know what's going on in the area, so that's not an issue. Cape Town is pretty safe in most areas. There are problems in what used to be the black townships and the squatter camps where people come from the rural areas and build shanties. So there's a high crime rate there, but you know that is a problem and it's not being properly policed. But where we are in our offices, there's virtually no crime. Johannesburg's a bit more dangerous. But again, you know, I lived in Johannesburg for 60-something years and I've been held up twice in those 60-something years, but I'm still here, you know. So as long as you're reasonably careful, it's not a major issue.
Ananda?
So it was wonderful to listen to you. I have a question related to two words you spoke. That is the discovery machine, and the other one is that equality, human resource, that kind of thing you said. Discovery machine, I think for a machine, it is not possible to do that kind of thing. Rather, the human network will be probably more applicable, not the expert, but the non-expert network. So what typically people call citizen science work. That may be able to solve this big data as well as the discovery machine thing, but we have to keep training the resources like that. Second question is, how do you think that the equality it will bring? Because I'm not that much happy looking at what kind of connection that a astronomy research can bring to the equality part, looking at what Indian JMRT has done so far.
Let me first say that the SKA is not going to solve South Africa's problems of inequality. That's definitely true. On the first question, there are two reasons for wanting to build a serendipity machine. One is that I just wanted people to think about how you do it. How do you find the unknown unknowns in the data? Whether you do it by machine, you know, you may have to do it differently. You can't do it by hand, though, because it's just too much. So what to look for and how to look for it, those are the things I wanted people to think about. As far as the question of inequality is concerned, when we started the program, some people said, well, why are you spending money on astronomy and not on housing? Why are you spending money on postdocs instead of on elementary schools? Well, the answer is that you can create some wealth by labor-intensive methods, but you can't isolate yourself from the rest of the world economy. So at the moment, what we do is we dig things out of the ground, we send them overseas, they're manufactured into electronics projects, and then we buy them back into South Africa. And that's not a, you know, that's an old colonial model. And it's not a model that's going to be successful forever. So we've got to break out of that. And the South African government for a long time has had a policy of developing South Africa's capability in the knowledge economy. But the problem is we've got lots of policy papers and white papers and green papers and so on that say we must get into the knowledge economy. But it's only through practical projects that you do it. So what we've been trying to do is to use the SKA as a catalyst to show people what can be done and how it can be done. And then saying to both government and the private sector, there are opportunities here, you can grow those opportunities. But it's not, you're absolutely right, it's not going to solve the problem of inequality in the short term. What we do have to do though is we've got to deal with inequality and we've got to deal with growing South Africa's wealth as a country. Now, how you balance those things, that's a more difficult question. But, you know, my attitude is this. I want to build the world's best telescope, and I want to do it in a way that's going to benefit people as far as possible. But we certainly can't solve South Africa's problems. That's a much bigger problem.
So I have two questions to you. One is regarding the curriculum. You mentioned that in the process of human resource development, you are running courses, MSc courses and PhD courses and all. Over and above the usual curriculum, you would have been required to modify the curriculum. So you are running these courses, as far as I understand, in different universities. So how do you do about that? That is my first question. Second question is regarding while you change the curricula and the courses, the structure of the courses, then you need to train the teachers also. So how could you do that? So I would be interested to know this.
Okay, so the answer to the first question and the second question is we don't change the curriculum and we don't run courses in the South African universities. They run their own courses. Where we have introduced new courses is in the other African countries which didn't have astronomy and they don't have data science either. So we've been working particularly with South African universities and with universities from Britain through this Newton program to introduce courses in Nairobi, in Mauritius, in Namibia, in Botswana, in Ghana. So at the moment, the courses are on two areas. One is on astrophysics and astronomy, and the other one is on data processing. And the data processing is workshops around data processing of astronomy data, but with wider application. So we're intending to expand those courses now. One course that we have introduced in South Africa, there's a new university in a town called Kimberley, which is the big town in this Northern Cape province where we're building. That's a new university, so we persuaded them that they should start a course in data science. So that's the country's first undergraduate course in data science. And they've got 40 students, all from that local area, all very poor families who are now studying data science. So we support that, so we brought them down to Cape Town last month and we had some projects for them and we worked with them and we got speakers from industry to come and talk to them and so on. So, but otherwise we leave the universities to themselves. It's only in the other countries. One of the nice things that's happened though is that we've had a lot of students from our partner countries and when they've graduated they've gone back and started teaching. So for the first time, Kenya has had an astrophysics course. Mauritius has been doing radio astronomy for years, but they've upgraded it now to PhD level. Madagascar is now teaching in master's level. Botswana is now appointing professors in two things, in astronomy and data science. Namibia is appointing in data science and science. So it's gradually spreading out.
Denise?
Yeah, I'm interested in the question of how you're actually going to get the power that is required for the SKA. And I'm also very interested in the question for the world in general of somehow finding a way to get reliable, sustainable, renewable energy. And just looking at the maps that you showed, you know, I was wondering if there have been any thoughts about maybe setting up solar arrays or some way of getting some renewable energy to support the project.
So there are different power solutions. We built a line, as you saw, from the main national grid. The grid comes to the town of Carnarvon, and then we built the line from Carnarvon to our site, and we've had to upgrade that for SKA 1. For SKA 2, depending on the power consumption, we might have to build a new line for 300 kilometers, which won't be cheap. But we're using the national grid, and the national grid is now incorporating more and more solar and wind power. So they've actually done quite a good job in getting in solar providers and wind. The problem, of course, is much more expensive than coal-fired power, which is what most of our stations are. And there's been a big debate now about whether we should have nuclear stations. We've got one, but they want to build more, or gas-fired stations. So there's a lot of gas being discovered off Namibia and off Mozambique. And that would enable us to build much cheaper power stations along the coast. So that we'll certainly supply the central site from the national grid, however the national grid is provided. But then for the outlying stations, it'll probably be a combination of solar plus something. So if it's near the grid, it'll be solar plus grid. If it's not near the grid, it'll be solar plus diesel. Australia's got a bigger problem because there's no grid in that part of Western Australia. So at one time, they were planning to build a pipeline from the natural gas pipeline that goes down their coast for 300 kilometres and then build a power station. But that's clearly not going to happen. So at the moment, they are working on a combination of solar and diesel. But there's a big working group in SK now looking at basically solar stations for all the outlying stations in Australia and in Africa. It's an expensive option, that's the problem. Yeah, the problem with these projects is that the world's needs don't necessarily show up in how much money they put in your bank account.
Gopal?
Could you tell us something about the status of private funding into science and education in your country?
Sure. At the moment, our expenditure on science research is about 0.8% of GDP. And our minister's objective is to get that up to 1.5% of GDP quite quickly. The private sector was investing quite well, particularly in two areas. One is mining and the other one's agriculture. But the mining industry is run down in South Africa, and so is agriculture. And with the economic problems since 2007, the private sector investment in science has dropped quite a lot. But luckily, government has been investing more money. So public investment in science has increased quite well. Over the last 2 years, the Department of Science and Technology is the only department of government that has got more money, not less. Everybody else had their budgets chopped. And the Department of Science and Technology was the only one that didn't. So we're hoping that that's going to continue to be the case. The private sector, you know, some of them invest well, but most of them, that's one of the things we're trying to change. In South Africa, there's still a perception that you can't do the best science and technology. You know, you must import it from Europe or America or India or China or wherever. And we're saying to people, it's not only the outside world that's got to believe we can do it, we've got to believe it too. And it's gradually starting to happen. That's why IBM, for instance, built a research lab in Johannesburg. Cisco has built a big lab in one of our universities in Port Elizabeth. And, you know, so we're getting quite a lot of development starting around this, but not nearly where it should be.
So how significant is the cost of transporting like 2,000 dishes from Johannesburg to the main site?
Sorry, the cost of...
How significant is the cost of transporting the dishes which are manufactured at Johannesburg and put it in the main site?
Not very expensive. So what happens is the pedestals are manufactured and they put on a trailer and they brought down. The roads in South Africa are very good. So they just truck down on a trailer. And then the space frames for the dishes and the panels are just packed up and put on trucks and taken down to the site. So it's not a major cost. But in any case, it's not my problem because we've signed a fixed cost contract with GD Satcom. They got to deal with that problem.
So you've built here an impressive operation, a logistical operation. There's got to be a lot of thinking that went into it. How did you make it into a well-oiled machine that actually works and delivers on time what was planned? And also, what did you plan to do? Because what you're describing is really amazing. You're attracting back the science people who perhaps went overseas. You're attracting foreigners to come to the South Africa. It's a dream, it seems, for any country that wants to develop and invest, and you also bring in the private capital. So do you describe what you've done so that others can emulate what you've done? And also I would be very interested to know, how did you come up with this such that actually works out in practice?
Well, in some ways we were just lucky. But also, mega projects, as I said earlier, are a special case. They don't, you know, it's not, if we'd gone to government and said, double the funding for astronomy, they would have said, we haven't got the money. If we went to them and said, we're going to compete with Australia for a big telescope, said, oh, compete with Australia, what a good idea. Yeah. We'll put money into it. So we were lucky also that the Minister of Finance and the Minister of Trade and Industry and various other ministers are very interested in science. So when we went to them and told them about the project, they were immediately interested and gave support to that. But we've also been very careful to be realistic with people and say, this is what we're going to do, this is why we're going to do it, and then we make sure we deliver on it. So what we had to do is to create a vision and get people to buy into it, and that's the public, members of parliament, ministers, scientists, and so on. At the beginning, we had a lot of opposition from other astronomers, for instance, and other scientists, because they said, you're getting all the money and we're not, you know. So we said, look, you wouldn't have got this money for zoology anyway. It wasn't there for science. It's a different pot of money. But gradually, everybody's come around. So we had to have the vision, we had to persuade people, and then you have to be tenacious, you know, you've just got to say, I'm going to force this thing through whatever happens.
So when you say we, how many people is that? Did you get to...
We should bid for it. He said, how much will it cost? They said, about 2 million rand. So 2 million rand is out now by a factor of several thousand, but, you know, there was... how they put it at the time, because I was just talking about the site bid. But Rob and Kotso set a condition. They said, we'll support this as long as you don't have a scientist to manage it, because scientists are not good managers. Now, that's not always true, but anyway. So then they both knew me, and they phoned me and said, look, you've got a background in science, but you've also had experience in management. Are you prepared to take on the project? So they gave me a contract for 60 hours a month, and I put together a small team, and then we started putting the site bid together, and gradually it became a bigger and bigger project. Then we persuaded them to build a CAT telescope, then we persuaded them to build a meerkat telescope, then we persuaded them to have the human capital program and so on. So gradually it expanded. But each time it's been linked to being able to show that there's a benefit for South Africa and a benefit for Africa. So for the African VLBI network, for instance, we got 140 million rand, which at the current exchange rate isn't worth much, but in the past was must have been about 15 million euros, a bit more than that, from the Department of Foreign Affairs, because they want to work with the other countries in Africa on science and technology as part of the foreign policy issue. So, you know, we're opportunists. I have a very strong principle, which is I always want to spend somebody else's money before I spend my money. So if I see there's money available somewhere, I say, okay, what's our plan to get that money? So we put the team together, and the team worked. They were all based in our offices. It wasn't a think tank, it was a project team. And Robin Kotso said, if we put you inside government, you'll never get anything done. You'll be bogged down in procedures and policies and bureaucracy. So they put us a little bit outside government so we could act like cowboys, which is what we did. So we made our own rules, provided we stayed within the Public Finance Management Act and we didn't steal money and we reported on it and the Auditor General checks us, you know. But other than that, we've been very free to make our own rules. If we'd been inside government, nothing would have happened because we would have just been writing policy papers up to now. So that was one thing. Then what was very important was we started with a bunch of engineers and virtually no scientists. Justin was just about our only scientist, and George. So these engineers didn't know how to spell radio astronomy. So we had to say, we want you to build one of these. And we thought we'd get the answers from all our colleagues in Europe and the UK and America and so on. And it turned out that these engineers were so good that very soon we were giving answers to other people, not the other way around. But we decided to follow a system engineering process. And a lot of people, scientists in particular, but also a lot of the software people said, why do you want us to do system engineering, you know, writing documents and so on? You're wasting our time. We'd rather just write the software. And we had a long struggle to get people to accept system engineering, but it's worked very well. So we do a strict system engineering process from requirements to level one requirements, level two requirements, interface management, configuration management. So
on. Is it RUP or is it Agile? What do you use?
Sorry?
What process do you use?
For system engineering? Well, we've taken the standard system engineering process that the military uses, but we've modified it to make it more flexible because we're not building a nuclear sub. So we've got to be able to, and then we use various computer programs. Core is the one that we store all the stuff in, and then EB for configuration management. But that was a struggle. Now the guys believe in it, but it wasn't easy to get them to believe in it.
Any more questions? Okay, if not, let us thank Bernie again. It's been a fascinating talk. I'm sure we're going to be talking about this certainly today and tomorrow and maybe several days beyond. So on behalf of ICTS, IIA, the International Organizing Committee of our program, I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
And this great story.
Thank you.